Dublin, as we know, used to be a prosperous port thanks to its naturally deep and sheltered harbour. Water has been a life source for the town since the very beginning. It's built on a ridge between the confluences of the Antron and the Penryn River. And the area, formerly known as Val Genoa, has relied on this water and developed into what was once one of the richest towns in the UK. In the 13th century, the town was granted a charter that allowed markets to be held on a regular basis. And when Glasley was built, the foreign trade and shipping industries took root. And at which time, half the population were foreigners.
Thank you very much.
Which made the place a bustling metropolitan centre. The sea is what has kept this town alive. And we're now going to go down and just find out how important this water really was.
Let's go find the sea! Okay. It's reinforced! This street is reinforced! The tanks came down here, the D-Day landing. So, a commercial street is a commercial road reinforced. So when builders dig down, they always get a bit of a shock. They wonder why.
I didn't know that.
You feel it now?
Yes!
It feels strong, doesn't it?
Welcome to Commercial Road. As Dan just so kindly mentioned, Penryn used to be a self-sufficient town with a number of its own trades and businesses, which included two paper manufacturers, corn mills, a brewery, a woolen and cloth factory, a gunpowder factory, an arsenic factory, concrete works, granite works, timber yard, coal yard, and at least 50 shops. Everything that you needed to live, Penryn could offer. Everyone had a trade, and there was a real sense of shared knowledge and skill amongst the town. In 1830, general trade covered 18 main trades and professions, and 14 years later there were around 50. And also, every road in Penryn leads down towards the sea.
Let's go and find the sea!
They have there's the back which leads straight onto the water. So when Marianne has a difficult customer, she likes to show them the back door and let them leave that way. So be nice to Marianne.
We should try it.
Most of their stock is imported outside the UK. The only thing that's manufactured in England is a few of their dry suits. Mainly they're things that are from Taiwan and Poland. And they get delivered via lorry, postal van, through this entrance. Marianne said that things used to, obviously because of the tidal, the big tidal change, it's difficult, but sometimes boats pull up and get their air canisters filled up directly from the back of the shop. And when the tide is high, it comes right to the level of the door. And when it's raining as well, her and Colin do worry that it might just come. It hasn't yet. But they worry. They say it's got parking, obviously, so it's got good access, but they say people come quite shooting along this road, and sometimes they're just not visible. They say it's okay because they're a specialist shop, people are usually looking for them, but they say good access, but sometimes people just don't notice them, so step back. Seaway's diving, everyone. You're diving me.
Let's go find the sea!
What we like to think is Glasley's sort of been demolished and like assimilated into the local buildings. We like to think that could possibly have been from Glasley, maybe, because it had to have cannons to defend against pirates, so possibly like the bricks we used from Glasley in the local building center, possibly like the bricks we used from Glasley in the local building center, possibly.
The upstairs of this building, as we were kindly informed by the lady Pam, who does it, this used to be the original sail maker's loft. It's currently a chandler.
Okay, right,
up here was the sail maker's loft. And as you can see on the floor, there are several holes and pins all the way along. The roof used to stretch the entire length of the building and was used, they would lay out the sails in here, pin them down for repairs. This part of the floor here that's missing to take the stairwell is currently housed in the Maritime Museum.
For its history.
Currently, if you look out the window here, you can see the modern sailmakers across the other side of the road.
Oh, there.
I don't know all the details, but there's a plaque for the office.
Alright.
On this side, it kind of curves round, and the water used to come round here.
We all live in a yellow submarine. Yellow submarine. Yellow submarine.
And our friends are all aboard. Many more of them live next door. The band begins to play.
All right. Let's go and find the sea! The main industry for Penryn always was the granite, and it used to be quarried up near May. There's a few quarries up there, and if you walk through the town and come down there, down to the BMW garage, that would be sort of granite works down that side, where they would shape it into blocks or statues or whatever it was needed for before it was shipped out. But a lot of it came in. This bridge was standing on the main granite and it was quarried in. And buildings in Falmouth, Mark B. Bank in Falmouth made of granite from the quarries up by May. And the viaduct, which was built in the 1930s, is also from the granite. So a lot of it stayed in Cornwall, but a vast amount was shipped out. And London Bridge in America is made from Cornish granite.
There's a statue of Winchester, the upgrade that's not entirely out of Cornish granite. It was also sent to Buenos Aires, Singapore, to go to our eventually reached a breaking point. I think there was a large gathering on Bodmin at one point. There was a sort of an eventual conflict. The royal family heard about it in London, and then the Prayer Book Rebellion came about. And it was crushed the same year, it was 1549. And over the whole of the southwest, I think 5,500 lives were lost due to the Prayer Book Rebellion. And as a result of that, I think it's quite interesting that the Bible was translated into Welsh, but it wasn't translated into Cornish. You know, I think that probably had something to do with the Prayer Book Rebellion, because like, it was just a southwest type thing. And then 100 years later, after that, in the mid-17th century, Penryn lost its custom house rights and market rights to Falmouth. And that was most likely due to Penryn supporting the parliamentary side during the English Civil War. So pretty much all its rights that it had given to Falmouth in that respect. So Falmouth began to flourish, Penryn began to dwindle a little bit after that. And then another 100 years later, so between 1760 and 1840, was an industrial revolution which directly affected both the harbours of Penryn and Falmouth. Railway, which all exports happened on then, so there wasn't much of it. There was virtually no industrial need for the harbours of Penryn and Falmouth, so it began to dwindle then even more. And some people have argued that it's never fully recovered from it, but I think its needs have changed over time. So, but yeah.
Our final stop is going to be at Jubilee Wharf, just in the little courtyard there. We were going to end on the bridge, and we thought that's kind of a fine
place. It's quite bleak. It's quite a bleak place to end it. Sort of Penryn's not what it was. Look at it now. But look at it now. Like, this building is pretty amazing.
And the Guardian wrote an article on it saying that it was in fact perhaps the greenest building in England.
So I just feel a bit forget about the building. Penryn used to be reliant on the sea. Now the local businesses are reliant on commercial road for their deliveries coming in from elsewhere in the country and from all over the world. On our trail, we've been interested in examining this shift of the role of the sea in this town and the effect it has on the identity of Penryn. Jubilee Wharf here is a creekside development made up of rented flats, felt craft workshops, a cafe, community hall, nursery and shops. All of this, and it has zero carbon emissions. And I guess the garden suggested it might be the greenest building. There's many local materials as possible, including red cedar and larch. And it was also built using mainly local labourers. It's a huge step forward in creating truly sustainable houses in England. And it's amazing that we have it here in London. It's highly insulated, it has solar cells, electricity, a wood-pellet biomass boiler, which cleanly burns compacted rubbish. It has its turbines. Like, it really is very self-sufficient, and the like bills of people here are like very, very little. So we've kind of been looking at Penryn as the idea of a new ecosystem, and looking at how small towns like Penryn can develop economically and socially, and even to a small degree they can kind of go back to how small towns used to be. And I think this development is kind of heading that way. Like, so yeah, we thought it stands for a lot of things that Penryn used to stand for: sort of craftsmanship, skill, and this real sense of community that they're aiming for with this sort of building. So we thought end here, and it kind of heralds a new, perhaps, chapter in Penryn's future. And we've got some little things for you. But other than that, that's kind of the end of the trail.
That is beautiful. The commercial trail is long. Oh, I thought you know what you were doing.
Oh. Let's go and find the sea.
Like a man just released from indenture, as a dreamer of dreams and a traveling man, hell, I chalked up many a mile. Read dozens of books about heroes and crooks, hell, I learned much from both of their styles. Son of the sun, son of the sun. Southeast.